Senator Risa Ontiveros expressing dissatisfaction with the statements made by Alice Go in their executive session Tuesday. Ontiveros, though, says one crucial personality was confirmed by Go, which corroborates a theory that the Senate panel shared a month ago. Ontiveros adds police personalities who were shown in photos with individuals involved in POGOs will be given a chance to explain their side. Senator Francis Tolentino, meanwhile, says another executive session will be held and he expects Go to divulge more information.
She was, very forthright. She was able to say something not spoken before. I think she will divulge a lot, especially with her conditions right now. I suppose that she slept in a plywood last night because of some bed bugs inside the small cell in Pasig. So I think with her physical condition as well as her health condition, she might be forced to say things not divulged before.
An update now on the proposed budget of Vice President Duterte before Congress. At a press briefing moments ago, she maintained her office will no longer show up before the plenary debates at the lower house. Duterte said they will instead find ways to work around with the approved 700 million peso outlay by the House Appropriations Panel. The Vice President, however, said she will attend the debates at the Senate, but she's no longer hopeful that the budget for her office will be restored to their proposed 2 billion pesos.
So 700 million, we will see kung ano yung maiwan, and then we will work around that budget of the Office of the Vice President. Pero definitely, tutuloy pa rin yung trabaho, anuman ang budget ng Office of the Vice President. Nag-aanday kami ng schedule galing sa Senate for the plenary budget hearing ng Office of the Vice President. So, a-attend kami dun. Pero wala na kaming expectation na mahabol pa yan. Kasi nga, sinabi ko doon sa interview ko, pagdating sa bicameral, kung nasaan nandun na yung dalawa, the Senate and the House of Representatives, wala ding nasusunod doon except si Zaldico at si Martin Romualdez.
Duterte also shot back at an erstwhile education undersecretary who was allegedly asked to resign after raising procurement concerns over the agency's computerization program. Duterte called Gloria Mercado a disgruntled employee who was let go after irregular activities, among them allegedly soliciting millions of pesos from a company using the VP's name.
Dapat siguro kung mag-akusa siya ng ganyan, dapat may papel siya. Tulad ng ako, pag inaakusahan ako, pag sumasagot ako, binibigay ko yung papel. Gloria Mercado is a disgruntled former employee of the Department of Education. She was let go because of loss of trust and confidence sa Office of the Secretary.
The Philippine Vice President skips a second House probe of the alleged funds misuse at her time as Education Secretary. Vice President Sara Duterte on Wednesday branded as unnecessary the House investigation. She also said it was based on unsubstantiated claims alleged by one of the panel's members, Congressman Rolando Valeriano. Similarly, Duterte has skipped the plenary debates for her office's proposed budget for next year. Her office's budget sponsor, Congressman Zia Diong, says Duterte's refusal to show up to the debates will not delay the passage of the government spending bill. He also believes Congress would no longer slash the OVP's budget after lowering it from 2 billion pesos to 700 million.
I anticipate that there won't be any further amendments and further realignment of some of the line agencies, because the proposal and or the recommendation of the Committee on Appropriations are funds that are alleged and identified to be the operation of the Office of the Vice President for its operation. Na mainly these are funds allotted to the PS, the Personnel Services, and also for MOOEs. So any reduction, personally, I would say any reduction from that proposed recommended amount would not render positively on how the Office of the Vice President would operate itself.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. certifies the proposed 6.35 trillion peso 2025 national budget bill as urgent. This would allow the House of Representatives to pass the General Appropriations Bill on second and third reading on the same day. Mr. Marcos says certifying the measure as urgent will ensure uninterrupted operation of critical government functions. House leaders are targeting to pass the budget today, that's September 25th. Congress leaders doubled down on this following their LEDAC meeting with the president.
Ngayong gabi po, maipapasa natin po yan on third and final reading and ready for transmission in short order to the Senate. Kaya itong pinaka-importanting batas na hinaharap natin po sa Kongreso at tas yung kumpiyansa ko na ito ay maitatapos natin itong gabi dahil sa pagka-certify ng Malacanang urgent po itong batas na ito po. Kaya that will be done.
At inaantabayan na namin ang pagbigay sa amin ng approved version o tinatawag natin GAB o General Appropriations Bill galing sa Kamara upang magsimula na ang talakayan tagkaugnay ng 2025 budget sa plenaryo ng Senado. Sa ngayon, on schedule ang mga pagdinig sa komite ng Senado at inaasahan namin na ito'y maaprubahan ng may sapat na panahon para ito'y mabasa at ma-review ng Pangulo kaugnay ng mga line item veto na maaari niyang gawin sa panukalang budget upang maging ganap na batas ito bago matapos ang taon.
A clash at the Senate over the voting rights of residents of 10 former Makati villages that are now under the jurisdiction of Taguig City. Senators Mig Zubiri and Alan Peter Cayetano engaged in a shouting match over the Senate's adoption of a resolution seeking to include the 10 villages in the two legislative districts of Taguig City and Municipality of Pateros, and confirming the increase of the number of councilors in each district of Taguig. Zubiri questioned the tackling of the resolution, which was authored by Cayetano, saying this was not part of the Senate's agenda for the plenary session on Tuesday. Cooler heads eventually prevailed, and Zubiri says everything is now good between him and Cayetano.
We made up already, no hard feelings. Pero ano kaya na kasi, they were passing something na hindi namin alam, wala sa agenda. I understood, that's when I understood that it meant a lot to him kasi Taguig.
Yes.
Pero alam mo naman ako, I'm a stickler for rules. Hindi tayo pitik mata na gusto natin pasalan tayo ng pasak. Ang malamag po ako, sabi ko, meron naman tayong bukas. Meron naman tayong session bukas. Medyo nagalit siya. Hindi tayo mag-aaway kung nag-focus tayo.
The Asian Development Bank cuts its inflation forecast for the Philippines while keeping its growth outlook. The Manila-based multilateral lender sees inflation this year coming in at 3.6%, down from its earlier estimate of 3.8%. It said the lower forecast reflects the sustained deceleration in food prices, partly due to lower tariffs on rice imports. It adds a sustained moderation in inflation could allow further monetary policy easing by the Banco Central. ADB still expects the Philippine economy to grow by at least 6% this year. Corporate stories today, San Miguel Global Power is listing additional senior perpetual securities. It told the local bourse the amount will be for $100 million to be listed in the Singapore Exchange Securities Trading Limited. The power unit of SMC is using the proceeds of this to cover development costs of solar energy projects, as well as to fund its battery energy storage projects. Next to Axelium Resources, the coconut products manufacturer, approves a ₱500,000 buyback program. That undertaking begins today and will last until March 24 next year. The company says the buyback is to increase shareholder value. Metro Pacific of the MVP Group has a 34% stake in Axelium, which it acquired last year for ₱5.32 billion. The Commission on Higher Education announced 92 higher education institutions, or HEIs, have been granted three-year autonomous and deregulated status. This figure includes 18 private HEIs, which were granted autonomous status. Chairman Prospero De Vera III cited their performance in professional board examinations, employability rates, and global linkages and engagements, among others.
First, we added the new criteria items to the evaluation of the status of private universities. We included internationalization because, as you know, the world is really globalized now as far as higher education is concerned. And the other one is we included social engagement or their public service. These are two new criteria items that were not in the previous evaluation system. Yes, there was an impact of COVID because some of our private universities lost faculty members, some did retrenchment. The accreditation system of private universities is slowed down during COVID because, as you know, everything was on a standstill. And research was also affected by COVID because there was very little research going on. So what we did was to adjust certain criteria items to take into consideration the impact of COVID. But overall, in terms of the universities that became autonomous and deregulated, my own sense is that the COVID was not a very negative factor because there were some schools that entered the autonomous status for the first time, meaning there was an improvement from their previous standing. Amidst COVID, they still improved.
An economist downplays the Philippine Central Bank's move to unload 24.95 tons of gold in the first half of the year, which made it the largest seller of the precious metal so far. JC Punumbayan says there's no need to panic, as gold makes up less than 10% of the country's gross international reserves.
For 2023, there was actually a huge decline in the net income of the Banco Central ng Pilipinas. So I think they're quite eager to find or look for these profit-making opportunities or activities in order to boost their net income for this year. Of course, we have to note that part of their capital was taken away for the Maharlika Investment Fund. If you look at the world price of gold, it's actually reaching an almost all-time high, or at least the highest in the past 30 years. And the Banco Central ng Pilipinas holds some gold as a form of is one of the types of gross international reserves as a buffer of sorts in case we have external shocks.
The BSP had said it sold gold as part of its active GIR management strategy. It added, despite the gold sales, the country's gross international reserves remained robust at nearly $108 billion. The Philippine Trade Department joins forces with the U.S. to boost Manila's semiconductor industry. For more on this, we have on the line Jackie Pascual. Hi, Jackie.
Good afternoon, Denise. Over 6,000 Filipino students initially will be part of the Semiconductors Workforce Development Program funded by the U.S. government in partnership with the Philippine Department of Trade and Industry, Board of Investments, and other Philippine state agencies. The program aims to provide training and education for Filipinos who wish to enter the semiconductor industry, which is one of the priority sectors of the Philippine government. This is part of the International Technology Security and Innovation, or ITSI Fund, a program or a $500 million program provided by the U.S. CHIPS and Science Act, which is designed to enhance semiconductor capabilities and supply chain resilience worldwide. For this workforce development program, $13.8 million was provided by the U.S. government for the Philippines, Costa Rica, Mexico, Panama, Indonesia, and Vietnam. Arizona State University is tasked to provide training to the teachers and trainers who will then teach the students. DTI Undersecretary Seferino Rodolfo said this program will help more Filipinos get free training on semiconductors, and this will help the Philippine economy, which relies on the semiconductor sector. The semiconductor sector is the top contributor to the country's total exports, accounting for 56.9% or $41.91 billion in 2023. Rodolfo hopes that more Filipinos will be enticed to join the semiconductor sector, which is a growing sector in the country. And in the long run, this program can help bring in more U.S. investments in the Philippines manufacturing sector, and the country can also increase exports. And that's the latest. Denise, back to you.
Jackie Pascual with that report. Thanks, Jackie.
Like the Philippine government expects to seize a record high over 40 billion pesos worth of counterfeit goods this year. Andrea Taguines filed this report.
Philippine authorities are eyeing a more than 40 billion peso counterfeit haul this 2024, a record high amid intensified operations, especially during the holiday season. Since the start of the year, the National Committee on Intellectual Property Rights, or NCIPR, has seized more than 35 billion pesos worth of fake products, the bulk of which were intercepted by the Bureau of Customs. That's already more than the country's total seizures for full year 2023, which was at nearly 27 billion pesos. And with the expected surge of counterfeit goods in the country these winter months, the NCIPR vows to be more diligent in monitoring the market.
Counterfeiters have turned to more sophisticated methods in this digital age, with online platform becoming a primary battleground for IPR violation. We will explore and adopt advanced technologies such as artificial intelligence, data analytics, and blockchain to improve our monitoring and detection capabilities.
According to the Intellectual Property Office of the Philippines, 60% of seized fake goods are different types of apparel, like shoes, bags, clothes, and eyewear, followed by perfume and beauty products, gadgets, and cigarettes.
Sa mga ating pong mga kababayan, nakikiusap lang po kami na gawin nyo na lang pong parigalo yung mga local products natin, di ba? Huwag na po yung mga fake na mga products. Sapagkat nawawalan po ng mga trabaho ang ating mga negosyo kung pagpapatuloy po natin yung pagbili ng mga fake products, nawawalan po ng kita ng gobyerno na magagamit po sa pangkalusugan, infrastructure. Natingin po naman din namin, ayaw din po naman ninyo na mabigyan kayo ng regalo na fake, di ba? Na hindi assured yung quality.
The Department of Justice, meanwhile, encourages more brand owners to come forward and pursue legal action against those behind intellectual property rights violations.
We are very diligent in monitoring the market and doing inspections. However, the enforcement aspect will always need the cooperation of the brand owners. So as long as we do our work, but the brand owners will desist on pursuing their criminal actions and even their administrative actions, this is just a vicious cycle that we have to contend with.
Andres also expects the Philippines to be removed from the Financial Action Task Force's gray list soon because of the government's work in addressing issues such as intellectual property violations linked to money laundering activities.
One of the deliverables is intellectual property rights violations on money laundering, and we are very confident that when the FATF gray list matter is taken up this October, it is very possible that the Philippines will already exit the gray list.
Andres added that the government has also delivered on the FATF's other concerns, such as terrorism financing and cross-border cases. Andrea Taguines, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine capital slides to the lowest in Asia Pacific in an annual list of global financial centers. The 36th edition of the index made public this week showed Manila at 30th in the region or at 110th in the world. The GFCI measures the competitiveness of 121 financial centers across the globe. The list takes into account five key areas, namely business environment, human capital, as well as infrastructure, financial sector development, and reputation. The index is jointly published by the British think tank ZN and the Hong Kong-based China Development Institute. Also in that list, Hong Kong reclaimed its spot as the number one in APAC after dethroning Singapore. China's financial hub Shanghai follows with Shenzhen, as well as Seoul and Beijing. Worldwide, the Big Apple stayed at the top just after London.
The U.S. Justice Department sues Visa for alleged monopoly over the use of debit cards in the United States. According to the antitrust lawsuit, Visa's practices have resulted in billions of dollars in additional fees for American consumers and businesses while slowing innovation in the debit payments ecosystem. It also alleges Visa charges roughly $8 billion in network fees on U.S. debit volume annually. Globally, that number stands at $12.3 trillion. Visa's lawyer, meanwhile, called the lawsuit meritless.